It was criticism against Jesus. They said, look at that guy. He's friends with sinners and tax collectors. We're going to conclude our sermon series on Fearlessly Forward. And we think about how the Spirit was at work in Jesus. He was filled with the Spirit. He was led by the Spirit. And so the things we see in Jesus, we might think about in our own lives. And what we're going to focus on today is that you and I might be like Jesus, be friends with sinners and tax collectors. And indeed, Scripture says, don't be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. So there's a sense in which we have to be careful who we're with and what we do. But there's also a very clear sense by God's Spirit in our lives that God would have us to be welcome mats, that we would be used of Jesus to welcome all kinds of people to the font of grace in Jesus Christ. God bless us in our worship. Good morning to the congregation gathered here at our Meridian campus. Good morning to our friends over at the Christ campus. And good morning to those watching on our Facebook live stream. May God continue to bless us and lead us and His whole church on earth during these days. And He will. Let's rise. We join in the opening hymn.
And now we begin ourselves in the name of God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Friends, let's receive the gift of forgiveness by confessing our sins. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a troubled and penitent sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I have offended you and for which I justly deserve your punishment. But I am sorry for them and repent of them and pray for your boundless mercy. For the sake of the suffering and of the death of your Son, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Forgive my sins. Give me your Holy Spirit for the amendment of my sinful life, and bring me to life everlasting. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. And to those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray the prayer of the day. Almighty God, you exalted your Son to the place of all honor and authority. Enlighten our minds by your Holy Spirit, that confessing Jesus as Lord, we may be led into all truth through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We continue with the responsive reading taken from Psalm 147. The Lord lifts up the humble. Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God.
For it is pleasant and a song of praise is fitting.
The Lord builds up Jerusalem.
He gathers the outcasts of Israel.
He heals the brokenhearted. He determines the number of the stars.
He gives to all of them their names.
Great is our God, and abundant in power.
His understanding is beyond measure.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son,
and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning,
is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The Lord lifts up the humble. Amen.
The congregation may be seated. For our announcements this morning, beginning this coming Thursday, our Thursday evening services will begin at 6 o'clock. We're losing the light. I think we're also losing a little bit of the heat. But if you're coming on Thursday evening, we plan to be outdoors throughout the month of October. If it rains, we'll have to come inside. If it snows, well, just wear snowsuits then. That'll be okay. But we'll keep our schedule. You know, the governor made another pronouncement this last week. We don't think that impacts anything we are doing or might do later this month. So we'll keep our schedule, except that the Thursday night will move to 6 o'clock beginning this week, Thursday. I want to invite you to be part of what we're calling Pastoral Succession Conversation. That's going to be next week, Sunday, on Facebook Live. At 12 o'clock, we want to talk about God leading our congregation. We want to see if that's what's going on, and we want the congregation to be involved in the conversation. For Pastor Sutton to become senior pastor of the congregation, and me to become an executive pastor of the congregation, whatever that is, that's one of the things we want to talk about. And so we've had some discussion about that, and we're looking at that, but we'd like the whole congregation involved. This is the first of many, but would encourage you to be a part of this next week, Sunday at noon. It'll only be Facebook Live, so there won't be any meeting here in this building. Coat Bank volunteers, we figured out a way to continue with a coat bank. And so October 10, 19, November 7, we could use a hand. The Michigan District is providing an online and in-person conference called Heart Issues Are Hard Issues, and this is to help us think through issues associated with racism and some of the events that are going on around us. If you're interested in that, there's no charge, but you do need to sign up. You can go to the michigandistrict.org website, and there'll be directions for that. That's October 15. I'd encourage you to take advantage of that. We have a road rally, a family and friends event on October 25, and you can see more information about that online. We continue to receive offerings either in the morning when you come, or you can give online. We continue to be grateful for people's continued faithfulness. I've asked Pastor Sutton to say a couple of words about Bible study as we get more and more toward the fall. Pastor Sutton.
Thank you, Pastor Davis. Yeah, we have two new Bible studies that I want to bring to your attention. The first one will begin next Sunday. The current Zoom Bible study that we're doing at 10:45 on Sundays is wrapping up today. So starting next Sunday, we're going to be exploring the book of 1 and 2 Corinthians. And I don't know how familiar you are with Corinthians, but it was Paul writing to Christians in a time of confusion and division. Sounds like today, right? Confusion and division. So we're going to be exploring reconciliation and unity in and through the book of 1 and 2 Corinthians. That's on Zoom, 10:45 on Sundays. And then also we have a women's Bible study led by Vicki Peterson. That is beginning this coming Tuesday. So that'd be the 29th, 7 to 8 p.m. And that's on Zoom and in person here at the Meridian campus. So that starts Tuesday. The book of Hebrews is what they're going to be studying. But I'd invite you to take part in both of those Bible studies as well as the other Bible study opportunities we have.
All right. Thank you very much. Let's continue with the lessons for the day.
Good morning, everyone. I'm here to read Genesis chapter 18. And the Lord appeared to him by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the door of his tent in the heat of the day. He lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, three men were standing in front of him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them and bowed himself to the earth and said, O Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, do not chastise your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourself under the tree. Will I bring a morsel of bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant. So they said, do as you have said. And Abraham went quickly into the tent to Sarah and said, quick, three seahs of fine flour, and knead it and make cakes. And Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to a young man who prepared it quickly. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. This was the word of the Lord. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Judy and I would like to extend our greetings to all our St. Luke brothers and sisters, especially those that we haven't seen for a while. We hope everyone is doing well and staying healthy. Our reading this morning is from the book of Hebrews, the 13th chapter, beginning at the first verse. Let brotherly love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Remember those who are in prison, as though in prison with them, and those who are mistreated, since you also are in the body. Let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled. For God will judge the sexually immoral and adulterous. Keep your life free from the love of money, and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper, I will not fear. What can man do to me? Remember your leaders who spoke to you the word of God. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Lord, before these feet of mine.
Gospel reading for today is from the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 14, beginning verse 12. May I ask the congregation to rise. He said also to the man who had invited him, "When you give a dinner or a banquet, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, lest they also invite you in return and you be repaid. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you. For you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just." Please be seated for the children's message.
Morning, everyone. This is week 6 of In Step with the Spirit, and we are going to be thinking about hospitality throughout the week. Pastor Davis is going to be teaching us about how the Spirit guided Jesus to welcome others. Jesus welcomed the sick people, hurting people, and sinful people. Jesus had a big welcome sign wherever he went. He said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden." This week, the kids have made a sign. Guys, what kind of sign did you make?
A welcome sign.
A welcome sign. When you hear the word welcome,
I think of like warm, loving, friendly embrace.
How about you, Caleb?
I think of kind and nice.
Yeah, those are all really good words to describe the word welcome. The technical definition of welcome means a way to greet someone in a glad or friendly way. Thanks for making the sign, guys. It's going to help us remind us the Spirit that is at work in our lives is a welcoming Spirit. We want others to come and be welcome, especially in learning about Jesus. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 35, it says, "I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me in." This is how God wants us to be to others. Let's say a prayer. Dear Lord, be with us through this day. Help guide us to to share your great love with others so others may come to the knowledge of knowing Jesus and receive salvation. We welcome you, Lord Jesus, to be in our hearts and help us to welcome others as Christ has welcomed us. Lead us through the Spirit that we may be good followers of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for all you do. Amen.
All right. Thank you for the children's message. Hope you've been enjoying those with different people providing those. Let's continue with our sermon hymn. And making our way through a sermon series entitled Fearlessly Forward in Step with the Spirit. Certainly these are difficult days, these are disconcerting days, but the last thing we need to be as Christians is to be anxious or afraid. God's Holy Spirit dwells within us, and so we're able to move fearlessly forward. We've been seeing about how the Spirit is at work. Over the last few weeks, we've come to understand, I hope, that the Holy Spirit is more modest than he is mysterious. It's really quite clear what the Spirit comes to do. The Spirit comes to guide us to look to and to look like Jesus. Now, we can't see the wind, but we can see what the wind does. We can't see the Spirit, but we've been looking at what the Spirit does in Jesus so that when we say, well, what's God's Spirit's will for me? Well, what's going on in Jesus? That's what the Spirit would have happen in our lives. Last week we talked about how the Spirit was at work in Jesus to sculpt him as one who was generous. We talked about his hands being opened. Today our topic is hospitality. We'll see how in Jesus Christ the Spirit is at work to put out a great big welcome mat. Hospitality and generosity, at the very least, have to be cousins. You know, can you make a distinction in your mind between the two? Maybe we'd say that generosity is more a transaction. This thing I have, I give to somebody else. Where hospitality would be more about proximity and relationship, that I'm with and around another person. We're going to look today at Jesus and his life of hospitality, his ministry of hospitality. The ancients called this guest friendship. And it was a highly valued characteristic in the ancient world, not just in Christianity, but the ancient world as a whole. In fact, one of the most famous stories ever told had its origins in guest friendship. Guest friendship that had been broken. If you read through Homer's Iliad, it was all about broken guest friendship. Paris stayed with Menelaus. Paris was from Troy. Menelaus was a Spartan. And Paris came and was received guest friendship with Menelaus. But then he broke that guest friendship by stealing Menelaus' wife, Helen. And the next thing you know, the Spartans are launching 1,000 ships to go chase down that face and to bring Helen back. It was all about guest friendship having been broken. Tony Campolo tells a story. You ought, look this up. He tells it in a phenomenal way. He tells a story. He was involved in Christian ministry, and he was at a conference in Hawaii, and he was going to make a presentation, and it was on his mind at night, and he couldn't get to sleep. So he got up in the middle of the night and found a greasy spoon or a greasy store, restaurant, looking for something to eat about 3 o'clock in the morning. As he's there eating, in through the door burst a number of ladies of the night. They were done for the night, and they came in, and they were loud, and they were boisterous, and he would overhear what they had to say. And as he heard them talking, one of them was talking about how her birthday was coming up. It was the next day, and the others were giving her a hard time. And as he overheard what was going on, she said she had never had a birthday party. Can you imagine never having had a birthday party? Well, the ladies had what they ate, and then they went on. And Tony Campolo got to talking with the owner of the Greasy Spoon and said, why don't we have a birthday party for her? Her name was Agnes. And the owner of the restaurant said, well, that sounds interesting. And he got his wife in. And the next thing you know, they're planning a birthday party for this lady. Tony asked the owner, he said, do they come in every night? Yeah, every night about this time. So they got a birthday party all set the next day. And sure enough, about 3 o'clock in the morning, in burst these ladies of the night. And a birthday party breaks out. Oh, Agnes is so overcome. She even asks, she says, I've never had a birthday cake. Can I take it home? So they partied and they had this celebration. And after the ladies leave, the owner of the restaurant talks to Tony Campolo. He can't quite figure them out. And so as they're talking, he says that he's involved in Christian ministry. And the owner says, well, I don't have much use for church. I don't have much use for all that stuff. He said, but a church that throws birthday parties for prostitutes at 3 o'clock in the morning, I could join that church. It's about guest friendship. Loving the lost, the least, the lepers, and even the ladies of the night. Guest friendship, that's what Abraham is famous for. We had that in the Old Testament. He's visited by these three, and he prepares a meal for them. It turns out, as we read through the rest of Scripture, it turns out it was the pre-incarnate Christ and two other angels, And we have the commentary from the second lesson today from Hebrews about this, where it says, be careful to show hospitality, guest friendship, because some have entertained angels unaware, pointing back to Abraham. Today, we're going to see that in some ways, hospitality, guest friendship, is a way to describe all of Jesus' ministry. When we think about the good news about Jesus, we think about courtroom scenes where we're declared guilty, God has us dead to rights, and then at the last minute, he puts our punishment upon his son, and we're declared forgiven. We're saved by grace through faith. It's God's gift. It's not our own doing. But another way that we can describe this same work of God is that God in Jesus Christ, by the power of the Spirit, extends guest friendship to you and to me and welcomes us in. We're going to think today about Jesus' guest friendship, 3 points. The first is Jesus came as an inviting host. Then we want to see that the invitation is for a banquet. And then the third point today, the Spirit sculpts Christians as welcome mats. How does the Spirit form us? Let's pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks that you sent Jesus to be a friend of sinners, to be a friend of the least and the lost and the lepers, the ladies of the night, and a friend to us. And we pray that even as you have welcomed us into your family, into your presence by the Spirit, you would send us out into the world individually and corporately to welcome others into the same good news we enjoy. May the Spirit lead us in that, for Jesus' sake, amen. The lesson that we have for today is from Luke chapter 14, and I'd like to give you a little bit of the context of that whole chapter. This takes place at a party, at a dinner party, with a Pharisee, one of the rulers of the Pharisees, and Jesus had been invited to be at this party, and it says they were watching him carefully. Jesus was an outsider to this group. Jesus was on the outs with them. They didn't like the kinds of things that he taught because he was often criticizing them. Jesus was an outsider. He was from Nazareth. Does anything good come out of Nazareth? He was a Galilean. Do you remember Peter on the night that Jesus was betrayed in Caiaphas's courtyard when he was denying Jesus? And the one person said to Peter, he said, well, no, you were with him. We know you're Galilean. We can tell because you talk funny. Jesus, did he talk funny? Did he have an accent? Was he from the wrong town? Jesus is with these others as an outsider. They were kind of extending guest friendship to him. But then he blew up the party. He said to them, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not? And you weren't supposed to do much on the Sabbath. And he goes ahead and heals a guy. And it says, and they could not reply to these things. He's causing difficulties with this dinner party. He goes on by insulting people, so to speak. He says, now when you go to a dinner party, when you go to a wedding feast, don't take the best seat, take the last seat. So that when the host comes and sees you sitting there, you can move up. He wasn't talking about wedding feasts. He was talking about the nature of the kingdom. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, but whoever humbles himself will be exalted. At the end of this chapter, he talks about a great banquet. He tells a story about a great banquet, and here's the punchline to it. It says, and the master said to the servant, go out to the highways and hedges and compel people to come in that my house may be filled. For I tell you, none of those men who were invited shall taste my banquet. Jesus told stories about banquets and about the kingdom and about how those who were invited on the front end rejected him. But how he sent others out to the highways and byways. Because Jesus is a great big welcome mat. He wants all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. And in the midst of all of this, we have this passage for today. Jesus said, now when you give a dinner or a banquet, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, lest they also invite you in return and you be repaid. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. Now, Jesus isn't telling you that you can't have family and friends over. Jesus is not giving us some kind of a lesson in mismanners, how to throw a party. Jesus is telling us about the dynamic of the kingdom and about how the kingdom of God works. That Jesus came into the world to invite all people, the least, the lost, the lonely, the lepers, the ladies of the night, the man with dropsy that he healed earlier at that party. Jesus comes as the host to invite. I mean, you see this throughout the New Testament. Seeking, that's the spirit. He tells stories about seeking for the lost coin, about seeking for the lost sheep. He said, the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. Our God is a searching God, a welcoming God. You go back to the beginning when Adam and Eve had fallen into sin, had thrown themselves into sin. God came calling. God came inviting. Adam, where are you? I want you to think today about Jesus' ministry as that of hospitality, guest friendship. You know the word hospitality. Sounds a lot like hospital. You can hear the word host in that too, all the same. In that word, can you hear this? Hostile. Hostile. The Latin word that's the base of all of these is really the word for enemy. That's what real hospitality is. That you come and seek and welcome your enemies. Those on the outside. That's Jesus' point in our lesson today. That's what hospitality is, to welcome your enemies. We talk about xenophobia, fear of strangers. Jesus came, xenophilia, friendship for strangers, for enemies. There he was. They'd all turned against him. Pilate and Herod let him down. The Sanhedrin and the leaders had falsely condemned him. People had spat on him. They'd whipped him. They'd beaten him. They'd put a crown of thorns. They put his hands to the cross with nails in them. They had treated Jesus as an enemy. And what was Jesus' response? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's real guest friendship. Welcoming the enemies. It was there on the cross that he says, I tell you the truth, today you'll be with me in paradise. That's the ministry of Jesus Christ. He says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. He says, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I would have gathered you together as a hen gathers her chicks, but you were not willing. The message I want you to hear today is no matter who you are, no matter where you've been, Jesus wants you to be with him. Jesus loves us even when we are by nature enemies. This is from Romans chapter 5. It says, but while we were still sinners, while we were still in rebellion against God, Christ died for us. While we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son. This is the gospel of Jesus. He comes and he says, welcome. Come be part of my kingdom. And that leads us to the second point. I want you to be clear on this. The invitation is to a party. It is a good thing to be a Christian. The invitation is to a banquet. How many times did Jesus talk about banquets? How many times in his parables was he telling stories about weddings and different kinds of banquets? What did they do after they found the last coin, the lost coin, the lost sheep, and the lost boy? They had a party. John is quite clear on this at the beginning of his gospel. He says, now this was the first sign he did in Cana of Galilee. What was the sign? It was a wedding party gift. The best of wines. Jesus is inviting us to the banquet into the glory. You know, we get bogged down when we read the Old Testament with a tabernacle and the temple and all of the sacrifices, and we get lost in all of that detail. What's at the heart of all of that? Feasts, celebrations, week long. They would sacrifice the bulls and the goats and all that, and the smoke would go up. But not all of it. Some of it was barbecue. That's the kingdom of God to come and to enjoy the abundance. Think about Psalm 23. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. At a funeral, we read about the banquet. It says, Isaiah 53, on this mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well-refined. He will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. Let the celebration begin. At the heart of our Christian worship is a banquet. It might not look like much to the world, a little piece of bread, a little sip of wine. But Christ himself is present in the sacrament and at banquet to fill us and to feed us. At the center of our life is this idea of banqueting. Don't tell anybody I'm equating church potlucks with communion. I'm not. But it's no accident that things like potlucks, soup suppers, and funeral dinners are a big part of our life. Because when God calls us to himself in Christ Jesus, he calls us to a banquet. We have a foretaste of it here. We have it without end in the kingdom to come. But we're not fully there yet. God's kingdom is breaking out, but it hasn't been come to its fulfillment yet. In the meantime, God has left you and me in this world to be a welcome mat. We are here to be a welcome mat, welcoming others into the kingdom. Not a doormat, but a welcome mat. That we would say to others, come, here is the food. You aren't disqualified. You can't be disqualified. Come and be a part of us. Leo Sanchez says, the church in exile, because we're still in exile, the church in exile must become a church for exiles. We're here to welcome others. Chrysostom, John Chrysostom, one of the ancient church fathers, says, since Christians are not judges of character but vessels of philanthropy, that means loving people, they practice hospitality, guest friendship, by unlocking the door of their hearts and welcoming sojourners in their need. When Jesus said, when you give a feast, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. He's talking about you and me going into the world, reaching others, so that on that last and greatest of all days, others might say to us, thanks. Thanks for extending the kingdom to me. Now here's the hard part. You know who Jesus wants you to ask? Invite. He wants you to invite those strident mask wearers that you have problems with. He wants you to invite those strident non-mask wearers that you're upset with. He wants you to invite Democrats, Republicans, people you don't see eye to eye, people you might even say, I'm against them. He wants us to invite people supporting Black Lives Matter. He wants us to invite, if you can imagine, he wants us to invite racists. God wants all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. You and I are to be used of God in a fearless kind of a way these days. When the rest of the world is upset and bickering and arguing against one another, we're here to be a welcome mat. Welcoming people from every nationality, every background, every persuasion, that they might come and be part of the banquet. Oh, they've got to leave some of that stuff behind. People have to be born again. They need to be cleansed of their sin. They need to be clothed in Christ. But that's not our work. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. Our call, our commission is to be that welcome mat, inviting others to enjoy what God has freely given to us. Over these last few months, we have lost a lot of banquets and parties and feasts. There have been birthdays and weddings and funerals and other holidays. There have been all kinds of banquets that we've done without. But we celebrate that there is a banquet to end all banquets coming. And God has the welcome mat out for you and me through Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. Until we get there, individually and corporately, let's be used of God by the Spirit to welcome others. Amen. Having heard God's message, I want to invite you to rise and let's proclaim our faith as we speak together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's prepare our hearts for prayer.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you have shown us guest friendship, hospitality, by loving us. Though we do not deserve it, though we are wayward sinners, you have invited us into your presence, into your love, into your kingdom. Having received your loving hospitality, fill us with the Holy Spirit so that we can go and do the same, and we can show loving hospitality, welcomeness to others. Lord, in your mercy, Holy Spirit, we celebrate the gift of life and hospitality that you have given to us in and through Christ Jesus. And Lord, we celebrate with the whole company of heaven today as Declan Cross will be baptized after service. Lord, assure him today and always of your love and mercy. Lord, in your mercy, precious Jesus, we thank you that you have poured out your Holy Spirit onto the church, that you've united us together in the Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask that we, as brothers and sisters in Christ, that we might live in unity and lead others to your peace. Lord, we ask that you would grant peace and harmony, shalom and Sabbath rest to our cities, our communities, our neighborhoods, our nation, and our world. Lord, in your mercy, most merciful God, we pray that you would guide your church so that it might proclaim your word of love to all people. Protect St. Luke and all Christian congregations from adversity. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us so that we might boldly and faithfully proclaim your good news. Lord, in your mercy, Lord God, grant health, wisdom, and integrity to all who are in authority over us. We especially pray for the President of these United States, the Governor of this state of Michigan, the Congress, legislative bodies, judges, and other leaders in our community and in our land. Grant them your Spirit so that they might serve according to your will and wisdom. Lord, in your mercy, Holy Lord, be with all who are troubled and in need, all who are sick or struggling. Lord, we lift up those who are ill or recovering from illness. We pray for those who serve in hospitals. Let them be vessels of hospitality to those who they care for. And Lord, we ask that you would give all of us courage to stand firm until the day of your deliverance. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, we now lift up to you our own private prayers and petitions. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we pray all these things in the gracious words that Jesus has taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Fearlessly forward. A lot of people are afraid about a lot of things. These are days of anxiety, but we have been filled with the Spirit, the same Spirit that filled Jesus, fills us, and so we go fearlessly forward to practice hostility. Hostility, that we would extend hospitality even to those with whom we're hostile or who are hostile with us. God is greater. May his love flow to us and through us by the power of the Holy Spirit who changes the lives. The Lord does bless and will always keep you. The Lord's face is shining on you. He will be good and gracious to you. The Lord looks on you with his favor, and in Jesus, he gives you peace. Amen.